couple of weeks ago, we had that Tuesday morning prayer meeting, and I was, I like to usually sit over there in that area, over by where Sister Carol's at, because that's anointed right over there.
Amen.
And I was just sitting over there, waiting on the Lord, worshiping the Lord, praying. A lot of us were praying, and I heard inside me the Holy Spirit say, "We're in a Cyrus season." Now, if you've been listening to the prophets, you know, over the last year or so, we've had a very contentious season with our presidential election and all the things that have been going on, which is usual when change is in the air, when God's doing something. And if you've listened to Lance Walla now and some other people, they've talked about how the Lord showed them that President Trump had a Cyrus, that he's like a Cyrus. He had like a Cyrus anointing upon him to bring about change. Now, Cyrus was a Persian king who, let me just start at the beginning. The Israelites didn't honor God's word for 70, every seventh year they were to have a Shemitah year, which is a Sabbath year where they let the ground lay fallow. It's a year of rest. And they didn't honor that 70 times in a row. And seven is the number of perfect completion. After seven hits, something's getting ready to change. So God came to them and he told them, "I'm going to take you out of the land. Nebuchadnezzar is going to come in from Babylon. He's going to overthrow this land. He's going to destroy the city. He's going to tear down the temple. He's going to destroy the city. He's going to take you into captivity. And you're going to live in Babylon for 70 years. For each year that you didn't honor the Shemitah rest, you're going to pay for that by living in Babylon for 70 years. And so that it's all in the scripture. If I had time, I could show you all the scriptures about that tonight. Matter of fact, Daniel 9 and 10, his revelations, he realized that they had come to the end of that 70-year period. So he starts seeking God for, okay, how's this going to turn around? Because I know you're going to turn it around. And you said that you would turn it around and take us back into the land, that it wouldn't last forever, and so forth and so on. And long story short, you'll see it tonight as we look at it. God raised up a man called Cyrus. He even named him prophetically in the book of Jeremiah. And he gave him his name and said that he would be used to open the doors, so to speak, to open the way for God's people in Babylon to go back to their inheritance. Everybody say back.
To
my inheritance.
My inheritance.
You see, your bloodline, your family, from the time that your family and your bloodline existed, there have been things that belong to you. And many times the enemy comes in and he rips off a generation. But you and I have to see, God looks at that when he sees somebody not fulfill their destiny on earth, or they die before their time, or whatever. God doesn't look at that and say, "Well, didn't work. Forget that." No. He looks at the next generation and he says, "You got some unfinished business here."
Yes. Amen.
And he transfers to that generation the ability to finish up what wasn't finished. He sees it as unfinished business. You know, I hear a lot of Christians talk about the family curse. And they talk about, you know, they see where God says, you know, it'll go to the third and fourth generation. Well, if the family curse is going to jump generations, what about the family blessing? What about the family heritage? What about the family inheritance?
Come on.
And I've got a lot I can say about this tonight, but it would take probably all night to say it. Because God's been teaching me things around this and about this since 2008. And one thing he said to me one night several years ago, he said, "Every spiritual heritage that's in your lineage behind you in your life is going to come to you in this day and hour." See, Hebrews 11 says somebody has got to finish the job, tie up the loose ends, bring forth the original intent of God in their generation. And that's why it says there, it lists our family heritage from Abraham on down and so forth, Noah and all those folks. And it talks about us in our generation or in our time under the new covenant. God has provided some better things for us.
Yeah.
Amen? Amen. That they, those people that already died and gone, are in the great cloud of witnesses, without us, would not be brought to perfection or completion.
Amen. Amen.
We have a greater, how can I say it, anointing, empowerment, ability from God upon our generation that has ever been on any generation.
Amen.
Yes, it is a responsibility. And the thing about the word responsibility is when God gives you responsibility, he gives you the ability to respond. And that is the anointing of God. So there are seasons in time when God, you know, something is done and it's time to shift the season. It's time to change things. In this case, it was time for them to go back to have their inheritance again, build the temple, and move on with God and have what God had for their nation. Now, our nation was founded on the Bible. I mean, all you do is take a trip to Washington, look at the buildings, and you'll see that we are a Christian nation.
Amen.
I'm sorry I take issue with our previous president. We are founded on the Word of God. Our laws are founded on the Word of God.
Amen.
And so forth. And if you study history, not the revised version, but the real history from the real writings, you'll see that it was God's idea to do this. God birthed it. No, it wasn't without conflict and trouble, and people have been mistreated, and things have happened. But tell me one thing that's ever happened on earth where some of that didn't happen.
Yeah. Yeah.
We can't get our eyes on what shouldn't have happened and miss what did happen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, I've got to get going here. I don't want to take forever to do this tonight. But I want you to see that there are seasons, and we talked about this before, how that when Jesus came on the earth, it was a spiritual season. The Greek word there in the New Testament, in the Gospels, is the word kairos, which means that which time allows you to do. So you can just waste your time. You can just take space and breathe air, and take up space and breathe air and go along and not even know what it's all about. Or you can connect with God and find out why you're here and what you're supposed to be doing.
Right.
And we're told in the New Testament we're to redeem the time. Because if you don't, the days are evil. Evil will just happen. Because the God of this world is here to do evil.
Right.
And you walking in that deception that's on your life, not knowing what you're to do to redeem the time, you'll fall right into line with that. Come on, are you here? And so, Jesus, when the Pharisees, they're confronting him, they're not receiving him, and they're, you know, all up in the air, he rebuked them. He said, you guys can look at the weather and tell whether it's going to rain tomorrow or not, but you can't see the signs of the times. There are spiritual signs that are all around you that are based in the Word of God, and you don't know what season you're in, so you don't know who I am and what I'm here to do.
Right.
So that wasn't just the Pharisees off into religion. That can happen to anybody. Anybody. You have to purposely want to know who you are and what season you're in. And so you're in a season personally. God's doing things in your life where he's, you know, shifting things, changing things. He may emphasize this in your life for a while. Then he'll emphasize this over here. But corporately, as a nation, we have come out of a season where we've had, since the 50s, we've had a demonic spirit of rebellion. It started in rebellion, and it's birthed forth a lot of crazy, nonsensical teachings, even in our college.
Yeah.
It's they tried to mix the Bible with unrighteousness, water and oil together. All these things have happened to where people are so confused now they don't even know what sex they are.
Right.
Now, I'm not trying to pick on anybody. I'm just telling you, some of the asinine things I hear people say, it just makes me shake my head.
Yes.
Not that I know it all, but I know enough to know what I am.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
Praise God.
Right.
Now, the Lord wants us to understand that we're in a time right now, and most of you have been around, if you've been, you know, in church here, and you've been, you know, seeking the Lord and trying to find out, we're in a time where God has heard our prayer. We've been praying. I remember the 80s. We had just started the church here. We went to a meeting in Fresno. Jerry Savelle had rented a theater down there in downtown Fresno, and he was going to do a teaching seminar thing there. And I walked in the building. When I walked in the building, I felt like I was in a, the only way I know how to describe it, it was like I was in a nursery where kids are playing. And that wasn't a judgmental thing, because, I mean, I was in there too. And it just kind of took me off guard. I go, God, what's going on? He said, people are still trying to do and hang on to the things that I've been doing for a while, but now things have changed, and you're in a new season. I'm going to emphasize something else.
Yeah.
And I said, well, what are you going to emphasize now? He said, prayer.
Yes.
And if you've been aware of what's going on since the 80s, there's been a shift. All of a sudden, all these prayer ministries start popping up. It's prayer, 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 pray, 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 prayer groups here and there. Brother Henry and Grace Fellaini, they travel up and down the state a lot and are connected with a lot of prayer groups. And Henry said there are tens of thousands of Christians in California interceding on a regular basis for our nation. Well, God put us in a prayer revival, if you want to call it that, a prayer movement to cry out to Him, because He knew that we were coming up to a place to where our nation was either going to shift back toward righteousness and we were going to have the destiny of the covenant that our forefathers made with God that He wants to honor, that somebody was going to have to cry out to Him and stand in the gap and make up the hedge in order for that to happen so that He could come in and give us our destiny as a nation. And that's happened, and we have now shifted. And I'm not saying it's all Donald Trump. Donald Trump has a part to play in this, but that's why the Lord the other day said that to me, because He knew my thinking wasn't totally in line, right? And He said to me, you, the church, your nation, all of you are in a Cyrus season.
Yeah. Glory to God. Yes.
So I began to study Cyrus in the Bible. Because I know that you know, God called Cyrus. He says, you don't even know me, He said to Cyrus in Scripture. He said, you don't even know me, but you're my anointed.
Yeah.
I'm anointing you. I'm going to take you by the right hand, He said. And I'm going to lead you. And you're going to do this great work.
Yeah.
God will empower people that don't even know Him in order to get His people where they need to be and to fulfill what He's promised them.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. I love it, you know, when it's time for Moses to be born, what's it? Perry Stone teaches us some real good stuff on this. There was a prophecy that had come forth. There's, you know, a lot of other ancient historical books, Jewish books, that talk about history. Well, there was this prophecy that Pharaoh was afraid of, and that's why he was killing all of the babies. He wasn't just afraid that they were going to outpopulate him. He was killing them because he knew that there was supposed to be a deliverer born.
Yes.
And Moses was that deliverer. Mm-hmm. His parents knew it. So instead of them throwing him in the river to the crocodiles, they put him in that little basket and hit him in the reeds. And God says, okay, devil, you're going to try to kill my deliverer? I'll make you raise him.
Yes.
He put him right under Pharaoh's nose. The deliverer that was going to take this whole thing and turn it around was put right under Pharaoh's nose. Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
I love it. Yeah. Hallelujah. Lord. So he talked to me about a Cyrus season. Now let's turn over here to... go ahead and turn with me over to, I was going to talk about the 70 years of Babylon and all of that, but we'll just let that go. We've already talked about that a little bit. Let's go to 2 Chronicles chapter 36. 2 Chronicles chapter 36, if you brought your Bible. If you did, then I may be preaching out of the Quran. You don't even know it. I'm kidding. We're going to put it up there, or is it working tonight?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. 2 Chronicles 36. Let's look at this. Let's start at verse 22. Now, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, remember the Jews have been in bondage for 70 years. Cyrus is there. The scripture was revealed to him that about his name. I think it was 300 years before this that he was named by the prophet and what he would do. That the word of the Lord spoken by the mouth of Jeremiah might be accomplished. How many of you know when God says something, it's going to be accomplished?
Yes.
The Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom and put it also into writing. Now when something is written, a king makes a decree. See, there again, we're in a democracy and we kind of see things differently. But the kingdom of God is a theocracy. The king is in charge. What he says goes. Matter of fact, the whole universe is under a theocracy. He is the king of the universe. The Supreme Court is not the Supreme Court.
That's right.
The courts of heaven are the real Supreme Court.
Right.
And there's one that makes a decision. He listens to the testimony of the great cloud of witnesses that are there to testify to him. Did you know you got relatives in heaven talking about you right now? They're not gossiping this time.
Yeah.
They're testifying to that spiritual heritage. You know, when you get to heaven, you know things that you don't know on earth. And they see things clearly. Anyway, that's a whole different subject. We won't get into that. But the king of the universe makes a decree. A king makes a decree. And once he decrees it, once he says it, it's put into writing. And it is written means it has been decreed, which means it is law.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
And it better be obeyed by everybody that's under that king.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
No wonder Jesus said, it is written.
There you go.
And you need to say it too. Devil, I got news for you.
Yeah.
I remember when Brother Hagin said one time, said the devil was attacking him, telling him he wasn't going to get healed this time, and he was going to die, and da-da-da-da-da, you know how the devil is. And he said, devil, in case you can't read, let me read it to you.
Amen.
It is written.
It is written.
Amen.
Amen.
So it says he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom and put it also in writing. Now, Cyrus was king over pretty much the known world at that time. God gave him a position of authority to affect the known world. You see, when God makes a decree, let's say he makes a decree that our nation, you know, is going to do this or that. That goes out over the world, and everybody in the world has to cooperate with that decree that God has said, if God's people will act upon the decree.
Yeah.
Every devil in hell has to bow their knee to it.
Right.
Every king of the earth has to bow his knee to it.
Yes.
Matter of fact, this decree that was made for the people to go back and the provision that was made, it took several kings being in office for this to happen. There are actually three different groups over years of Jews that went back to the land, and it took some time. And there was attack from their enemies. There was delay. One time the building of the temple stopped for 15 years. All these things happened, but every time the king that was in office, when this issue came to him, he would go back and find this decree that was written by Cyrus, that was spoken and written by Cyrus, and they would say, yes, that's what was written, that's what was said, that's what we're going to do.
That's right.
See, that's the thing the devil doesn't want you to know.
Right.
That word that's been spoken to you, that word that's been decreed about your family, he'll fight you, he'll try to get you to not believe it, he'll try to get you to give up on it, he'll try to, you know, put the heat on you, persecute you, but you take him right back to that decree, and you stick that thing right in his face, and you say, it is written, he has to bow his knee.
Yeah.
When Jesus told him, it is written, the devil had no answer to it.
That's right.
It had been decreed from heaven.
Amen.
And you've got a book, praise God, that God's given you of his decrees.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Verse 23, thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, all the kingdoms of the earth hath the Lord of heaven given me. Woo! And he hath charged me to build him a house in Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Notice, Cyrus understood this. I've been commanded by God to use the kingly position, the authority, the provision, all that I am and all that I have, that he's given me to, he's charged me to do this thing. Praise God. It's like the Great Commission. It's not the Great Suggestion. It's a charge. It's upon our lives.
All right.
I am to do whatever I can to see to it that the gospel goes forth in the earth.
Yes.
Amen.
I am to financially help that. I'm to pray. I'm to do whatever. Whatever God shows me to do, whatever he shows me to be, I'm to be a part of that. That's his kingly decree that Jesus made when he rose from the dead.
Right.
It says, who is there among you of all his people? Now he's talking to the Jews. The Lord his God be with him and let him go up. In other words, I'm releasing you. Now's the time. The 7 years are over. I am decreeing right now, and I'm saying it's time to do it. Go get it.
Yeah.
But you know, only a remnant of the people went home. Many people got comfy in Babylon. Their business was working. It was life as usual. My family's been here for 70 years. And even now, just in recent history, some of them have come out of Babylon back to Israel. In modern day time, there's always been Jews there from way back. So this was the decree, or this was the thing that was on Cyrus's life, and on his country, and in his life. Now, you know, there are these things, these anointings, these things like this that happen, these seasons, they cycle through. You see them in cycles in the earth. For instance, let's take the Antichrist spirit as an example. The Bible says that the Antichrist spirit has been here. Well, you see it manifest after the flood. You see Nimrod try to build a tower, a citadel. And if you really study that thing out and find out what it's really all about, what Nimrod was doing was saying, God, I'm not going to do what you say. I'm not going to be scattered across the earth here and follow your plan. I am going to be a God man. Same lie that Adam and Eve fell for. You don't need God. You can be God in your own life. And I'm going to build this thing, and we're going to, you know, we're going to have this. And it was the beginning of a succession of kings. The Pharaohs picked this up, where they were actually seen as God men. They were worshipped as gods. We've even had that in our modern time. Back during World War II, the emperor of Japan was seen as a god. And those people followed him because they believed he was a god. And so this Antichrist spirit has been here since ancient times. And I heard somebody one time at a prophetic roundtable, there were some questions about end times. And this one person asked a question and says, well, how come people have believed, you know, this person was the Antichrist, then this person was, and now this person? How come he? And one of the people answered, and I thought it was really the answer of God, the wisdom of God. They said, because every generation has their Antichrist. Because it's a spirit. See, the devil doesn't know as much as you think he does. The Bible says that no man, even the angels of heaven, even the Son of God himself, does not know when God's going to wind this thing up. So the devil is trying always to take control of the prophetic time clock, beat God to the punch, so every generation he'll raise up somebody and put that Antichrist anointing upon them, that false anointing, for them to go out and to try to mess the world up and take control of it. Adolf Hitler had that on his life. He wasn't just some crazy person. He had an unholy anointing upon his life to influence people to follow him into something. And all the characteristics of what Jesus is going to do in the millennial reign, the thousand-year reign, what was Hitler saying? The Nazis, the Third Reich will reign for 1,000 years. All of these things were there. Why? Because that Antichrist spirit had cycled through again.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, the same thing is true of this Cyrus anointing. When a season arises and it's time for a nation to return to their inheritance, to build the house of God, to have what God has for them, that Cyrus anointing comes upon people. As a matter of fact, when it was time for the Jews to come home, back to their land, after World War II was over, Harry Truman was the president, and he wasn't really all in favor of going along with all of that until a Jewish man that he spent time fighting with in World War I came and visited him one day and explained to him about the Jews. And all of a sudden now he realized what was going on, and he began then to use his power and authority as the president of the United States to release things and to influence things, so that the Jews could literally come back to their land. As a matter of fact, at one point, he said, I'm Cyrus.
Wow.
He recognized somehow that there was something on him like Cyrus. It was that anointing. It was that thing cycling through again. And we are in that time right now for our nation. Because our nation is off track.
Mm-hmm. Right.
There are, if Jesus Christ came right now, there would be billions of people go to hell. Multiplied millions in this nation. Because they don't know Jesus. They haven't gone through the door. Well, there's many pathways to God. Yeah, there may be many pathways to Him, but there's only one door. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by and through me.
Amen.
Yeah, that's true.
Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. So turn with me, where did I say to turn? 2 Chronicles, chapter 36. No, I'm sorry. Isaiah 44, I'm sorry. I got so many scriptures here, I don't know what I'm looking at. Isaiah 44. Now I know this is kind of a long, going to be like a teaching thing here tonight.
It's good.
But we need to understand what season. I don't want to be like the Pharisees, running around fighting God.
Right.
Because I'm too ignorant to know what season I'm in.
Right.
And it's not a political thing. It'll influence politics. It's not a racial thing. It's not a rich and poor thing. It's about God shifting the nation back to a place where he can be and do what he wants to be and do in this nation.
Amen.
And that is to prosper people, bless them, and use them to influence the rest of the nation.
Yes.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Isaiah 44, look at verse 24. For thus saith the Lord thy Redeemer, and he that formed thee from the womb, I am the Lord that maketh all things, and that stretcheth forth the heavens alone, that spreadeth abroad the earth by myself. I think he's making a point here, isn't he? That frustrateth the tokens of the liars, that maketh diviners mad, that turneth wise men backward, and maketh their knowledge foolish, that confirmeth the word of his servant, and performeth the counsel of his messengers.
Yes.
Talking about the prophetic there. That saith to Jerusalem, you shall be inhabited, and to the cities of Judah you shall be built, and I will raise up the decayed places thereof. Now see, this is during a time, Isaiah's prophesying here, when they're in Babylon, and God shifted gears about chapter 40 here or so, and before he was all talking about what was going to happen to them because of their rebellion, he shifts gears and says, okay, now we're going to start talking about going back. God always starts talking about what he's going to do long before it happens.
Yeah.
Because he has to get us lined up
with
it. Plus, he has to release that commandment, that decree, through the prophetic voice in the earth in order for the atmosphere to line up, the angels to come in, and things to happen so it can happen.
Yes.
That's a whole other sermon, too. We'll get into that either, I don't think. Verse 27, and saith to the deep, be dry, I will dry up thy rivers. That saith to Cyrus, he is my shepherd. Isn't that amazing? God's got a shepherd that doesn't even know him. Mm-hmm. That shall perform all my pleasure, even saying to Jerusalem, thou shalt be built, and to the temple thy foundation shall be laid. He said, I'm going to use him as a shepherd, and he's going to open his mouth because I am going to decree something through him, and he's going to say that Jerusalem will be built, and the temple and the foundation shall be laid. And that's exactly what he decreed. Verse 1 here in chapter 45. Now, Donald Trump is our 45th president. And this chapter 45, I believe, coincides exactly with the reason that he's in office right now. Now, there again, don't misunderstand me. It's not all about him.
Right.
But he's a symbol of a shifting that's happened.
Yeah.
And the spirit that was on Cyrus was an aggressive, type A personality that just blasted through all the resistance. He was the wrecking ball during his day. And he took all these other kingdoms under him. Like I said, he ended up overseeing pretty much the whole known world at that time. He shifted things into a place. And the Bible says it was because God was opening doors for his people.
Yeah.
Amen. To go back. Amen. Thus saith the Lord to his anointed Cyrus, whose right hand I have holden, to subdue nations before him. It wasn't Cyrus subduing nations, it was God going before him.
Yes.
Directing him, holding his hand, leading him into it. I will loose the loins of kings. In other words, I'm going to put fear in kings. I'm going to take their authority, their power away from them.
Yeah.
Yes. To open before him the two-leaved gates, and the gates shall not be shut. There will be nothing the enemy can close against him. And shut in things that belong to us, or shut us out. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. I will break in pieces the gates of brass and cut in sunder the bars of iron. These things that the enemy has set up to try to hold people in, bars of irons and jail cells, the gates of brass. Brass speaks of judgment. You know that maybe there's been wrong done somehow by the enemy's capitalized on that, and the judgment's come, and he shut this thing up legally to keep you out of it. God says, I'm opening those gates. I'm cutting those bars. It's time for things to open up. Verse 3, and I will give you the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places, that you may know that I, the Lord, which call you by your name, am the God of Israel. Notice he didn't call himself the God of Babylon. Amen? He was letting him know why he was doing this. For Jacob my servant's sake, and Israel mine elect, I have called you by your name. I have surnamed you, though you have not known me. I am the Lord and there is none else. There is no God besides me. I girded you, though you have not known me, that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none besides me. I am the Lord, and there is none else. I form the light, I create darkness, I make peace, I create evil. I, the Lord, do all these things. Now, of course, he's saying this in the context of him opening this back up. And if he has to destroy even people, he'll do it. Mm-hmm. You don't want to be God's enemy. It's not a good idea.
No. No.
Drop down, ye heavens, from above. Notice, heaven's coming onto earth. God is invading the earth.
Yes.
Drop down, ye heavens, from above, and let the skies pour down righteousness.
Amen.
Let the earth open, and let them bring forth salvation, and let righteousness spring up together. I, the Lord, have created it. Glory to God.
Yeah.
So God's saying here, this is what Cyrus is going to do. This is who he is, and this is what he's going to do. You know, we have a culture now that if you're not sweet to everybody, over-sweet to everybody, that you're a bad person. That's nonsense.
Yes.
Right.
The Bible says open rebuke's better than secret love.
Yes, yes, yes.
I'd rather have somebody look me in the eye and tell me, John, you're wrong, and the enemy's deceiving you, and problems are going to happen in your life if you don't get that right. And make me mad, you know, embarrass me a little if need be. I'd rather have that person as a true friend to me than some person who smiles and is stabbing me in the back or wishing me evil,
right,
or they're manipulating things around to do things their way. I'd rather have that person get in my face than to have somebody else.
Amen.
Now, we do need to be gentle. We do need to be kind. We need to be loving with people. But just because that's the case, sometimes you have to be straightforward with people.
Yes, amen.
Yeah.
Paul said, knowing the goodness and the severity of the Lord. God loves people. He gives what they call, not general grace, but I forget the word that's used. The Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust.
Right.
Rains a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
We tried doing without rain for a while around here. Not much of a blessing.
Oh.
He reigns. There's this common grace. That's what it's called. There's this common grace that's upon all people. God loves all people. But if you're headed down a pathway that's going to cause your destruction, or you've decided of your own free will that you're going to fight God and you're going to do whatever, God will get in your face, and you need your face gotten into.
Yeah. Amen.
Hallelujah.
The devil has deceived us into thinking that if we don't agree with everybody just being whoever they want to be, that we don't love them. I love them enough to tell them the truth. If somebody's going to hell, I don't want their blood on my hands. I'm going to pray for them and love them. If God gives me an opportunity to speak to them, I don't care if they hate me for the rest of their life. I love them too much to let them go to hell.
Yes.
So we've got to get over this little nonsense crybaby stuff.
Yes, amen.
I'm offended.
Get over it. Get over yourself. It's not about you anyway.
Yes.
If it's about you, you're not walking in love.
That's good.
I've had people hate me. I've had people do things to me. I've had all kinds of things happen since I've been here pastoring. I don't care. Now, I'm not saying I wasn't hurt. I wasn't saying I didn't get upset. I'm not going to say I didn't get angry. But I got over it. You know why? Because it's not about me. I'm serving God, and God's going to give me everything I need. He's going to take me forward. He's going to use me to be a blessing if I listen to Him and yield to Him. It's not about me.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, I didn't plan on saying that, but I won't take it back either.
No,
amen.
No.
So God promised to help Cyrus in order to open the pathway for the Jews to return and build. Now, that's what's on our nation right now. We have gotten so far away from the foundational truths that this nation was built in, that people, the average person in this nation, wouldn't know the truth if it slapped them in the face.
Yes.
And that's just a fact. Mm-hmm. I had another experience where the Lord showed me a timeline. He showed me 2017 back into the 50s. And it was like a regular timeline, like you'd write out a timeline of years. But it was covered by this covering, like a blanket or a veil. And I saw God reach over in 2017 and start rolling the veil back like this, exposing the years. And I asked him what it was at. He says, I'm going to do a work. And I'm already seeing it happen. I'm going to do a work where I'm going to reveal to the generation that's alive right now what started in the 50s the seeds of rebellion that started, that began to fully manifest themselves over into the 60s and 70s, and now there's this place where we stand against God, and many times, and many people think they're for Him when they're against Him.
Right, amen.
Yes.
Yep. Blind.
Because they don't know what love really is.
Yes.
And there's been this mixture of good and evil. The Bible says if you go down that pathway long enough, you call good evil and evil good. Amen. But He showed me, He said, one of the ways I'm going to bring the millennials in and I'm going to bring this generation in is I'm going to expose the half-truths they've been taught in college, the outright lies they've been taught in college, the emphasis on things. Not, see, all you got to do to tell a lie is just tell half the truth.
That's right. Yeah.
Sure.
Amen.
I have had people do that to me forever. Usually you see it in a marriage situation. Somebody will come in, you know, you don't have both people together, just one person. And they'll tell me their side of the story. Now, they may believe their side of the story, and that may be even them being truthful from their perspective. But I found that in a marriage, you need to hear both perspectives to get the whole truth.
Yeah.
And then there are people who purposely just come in. They don't want you to think bad of them as the pastor or whatever. And so they just tell you the bits and pieces they want. And I even have people come in, they want me to get on their side and get after this other person. Because I'm not going to be a fool. The Bible says a person that judges a matter before he hears it completely is a fool. I've had people threaten me. You need to make my wife do this, this, and this. I'm not going to make your wife do anything. She ain't my wife. Yeah, you let the cat out of the bag.
I know that. Hallelujah.
I hope this isn't on the internet right now. Praise God. So the Lord was showing me, He says, I'm going to reveal. I'm going to open it up, I'm going to reveal it. People are going to see it. They're going to see it. And He told me, He said, a lot of these millennials are going to get so mad when they see the lie and the deceptions they've lived under. That the generations before my generation has told them that they're going to completely rebel against that whole thing.
Yes.
And you know what's on the other side?
Yes.
God.
Yes.
Yes. Amen. Amen. I'm not saying everybody's going to be that way. But I know what He showed me.
Yep.
Praise God. Okay, let's turn over to Ezra.
Thank you.
A book you read a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Remember Uncle Ezra?
Yeah.
Ezra. It's page 622. It's after 2 Chronicles.
That's fine.
The book right after 2 Chronicles. The book of Ezra. We're talking about a Cyrus season. We're talking about an anointing and a mantle that's upon this nation to turn the nation back to its foundations. You see, it's one thing to have a few boards blow off of your house, go through a storm, you lose a few shingles, even maybe a wall get, you know, damaged. But if your foundation's wrong, that house is coming down.
Yes.
And when I hear people talking about changing the Constitution. I hear them talking about, you know, it's not relative to today. The reason it's lasted 200 plus years is because it is relevant all the time. Because it's built on the Word of God. It's built on justice, truth, and righteousness. That all men are created equal. And the form of government, if it's done right and you've got honest, righteous people in there, it allows things to be done in such a way that God can bless you and bless the nation.
Yeah.
Yes. When I hear these words, like fundamental change,
ooh,
you know what that means? That means I'm changing the foundation.
Wow. Yeah.
Well, that foundation was set with a group of people that made a covenant with God.
Yes.
You know, when they were trying, after the Revolutionary War was over, and they were trying to put the Constitution together, it wasn't working. Because there was like 13 different colonies, and they were all arguing, and you know, like we do as people. And finally, I think it was Benjamin Franklin, if I remember correctly, he stood up one day and he said, you know, while we were in this war, every day we had a minister who would pray over us and pray over our situation. And even in times when we should have lost, we should have been defeated, God intervened supernaturally for us and gave us victory. That war, we should have lost that war in the first 10 days it started. It was a David and Goliath thing all the way. It was laughable for a group of 13 little colonies, pioneer, organized people, to stand up against the greatest nation on the face of the earth with all their armaments and all their ability to make war. It was God. And so he stood up when they were trying to do the Constitution. He said, I make a motion that we hire a minister, that he comes here every day, and that we start these meetings with prayer and with the blessing from that man.
Oh, praise God.
And when they started doing that, all of a sudden, the Constitution started coming together. They honored God, and he gave them light.
Yes.
Amen?
Yeah.
Praise God for that. Amen? Amen? So here we are in Ezra 1. Ezra was one of the men that took a group of people back to the land as they were doing this thing. Now see, God is building a temple. I didn't have time to turn over to the scriptures tonight. Let me go ahead and just do that real quick. Put your finger there in Ezra, or mark Ezra, and turn with me over to, let's go to just one here, Ephesians chapter 2. So you have to take the Old Testament and transition it into the New. The Old Testament is the New Testament concealed. The New Testament is the Old Testament revealed.
Yeah.
Amen? In other words, the spiritual principles, these mantles, these cycles, all these things, they're all true. But what God is doing in our day, he's not building a physical building temple. He's building a corporate, glorious temple of people. Peter says that you and I, when we get born again, we become a living stone in that building. Now look what it says here in Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. Now therefore, you, talking to the church at Ephesus, are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. Glory to God. You're in the family. Amen? Now look, verse 20. And are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. What they taught, what they established as foundation. Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. So we take our measurements from Jesus. Amen? You measure it up him. You know the old, what would Jesus do with the bracelets and all that? That's what that means. You look at him. How would he handle this? What would he say? He's the foundation. He's the cornerstone. But it says, in whom, verse 21, all the building, the corporate building of people that he's building up, fitly framed together, groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord. In whom you also are builded together, corporately, for a habitation of God through the Spirit. So he's building a glorious temple of people. Remember when Peter and John got beat up for raising the man at the gate beautiful, got threatened? What did they do? They went to their church. They went to their own group. And they said, here's the threats that they made. And they all got together as this glorious church group. And they lifted their voice in one accord. And God shook the building. God came. He inhabited them. And the level of glory that was happening in that revival, in that move of God, went to a whole greater level.
Yes.
Amen?
Yeah.
Because they operated as that corporate temple of God. These folks that say they don't need a local church, they are wrong.
Right.
Dead wrong.
Amen.
You need a group of people to be around. If you're not the Lone Ranger, you're going to end up being the lone stranger if you don't watch it. You need to get in with other people that are going to build your faith up. You know, we come in here and the corporate anointing, the corporate presence of God is much greater.
Yes.
How many of you have been encouraged when you've gone into your local church, you've gone into that place and you've worshiped with others and you just get caught up in the glory cloud that's there?
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
So God is still doing what he was doing back there in those days that we're talking about. He's still building the temple. He's restoring. He's bringing people back. See, this whole thing from Genesis all the way through is about him restoring what was lost in the Garden of Eden. Taking all of creation back to a place and filling it with his glory. You know, God, when the children of Israel rebelled out of the wilderness and God was going to destroy them and start over with Moses. Moses interceded. God says, okay, I won't kill them, but I'm not, they'll be in the wilderness 40 years. But he says, but as surely as I live, Moses, this earth's going to be filled with my glory.
Yep.
That's what he was pointing toward all the time, see? And that's what he's still pointing toward. And a great part of that is you being a part of that corporate, habitable, glorious church. Amen. No wonder the devil wanted to take us away from that. So back over here in Ezra chapter 1, verse 1. This is the decree. Well, we're going to wind it up with this. Because I want you to transpose or transition this decree into the day we're living in right now.
Yeah.
Now, the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled. The Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom and put it also in writing, saying, thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord God of heaven hath given me all the kingdoms of the earth and hath charged me to build him a house in Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Who is there among you of all his people? His God be with him, and let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, and build the house of the Lord God of Israel. He is the God which is in Jerusalem. And whomsoever remaineth in any place where he sojourneth, let the men of his place help him with silver and gold and with goods and with beasts, besides the freewill offering for the house of God. So this decree coming from God through Cyrus in his earthly position, God released the decree through him, and he said, the door is going to be open. They're going to go back. Let them go back and do that. And I command you to participate in it. The Bible says the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just.
Ooh, yeah.
Right.
God wants to give you favor with people that don't know God.
Absolutely.
God wants people that to bless you and don't even know why they're blessing you.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Notice it says, help him with silver and gold and with goods. What's that provision? To get the job done. So we can help finish up building the house here.
Amen. Yeah.
We can help finish up this move, this revival, the evangelization of the world, the harvest.
Yes.
Amen.
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 God has decreed, and I'm telling you, if we'll make a demand upon that, God will bring favor to us.
Amen.
Praise God. Linda, earlier in the service, when I was sitting over there, I believe the Lord said this to me, to you about the center. It's going to be better than you thought.
Yeah.
Better than you thought.
Yeah.
Oh.
Amen.
Yeah.
Praise God. Because see, and this is the time. Now, prophetically, we've been hearing this. We've been prophesying this. We've been speaking this. This is a time for people to receive stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
It's time for you to receive it. Not so you can consume it on your lust and you can have a better car than you had last year. God doesn't mind you having. I don't think God cares what kind of car you ride.
Oh, sure.
If you like riding a donkey, I don't think it bothers you. You know, whatever. Have fun.
Go to the chiropractor.
Yeah, go to the chiropractor. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. It's not about that, but it's about what God is doing. If you want to live a blessed life, you find out what He's doing and get in there and do it with it.
Amen.
And you'll have the provision that you need to have.
Yes.
Let me just say this. I've said it before. Everything you'll ever need spiritually, soulishly, physically, financially, socially, is in the will of God for your life.
Yes.
Yeah, but every time I go to serve God, I start getting attacked by the devil. Duh! That's why!
Exactly.
Yeah, but you know, it's hard being a Christian. No, it's not. The Bible says the way of the transgressors. Well, it's hard. Because you get deceived going along, think it's working, and all of a sudden you get the rug jerked out from under you, and you find your head where your feet were before. Amen?
True.
The Bible says the exceeding wicked will heap up riches, and in one day they'll be cut off.
Amen.
Yeah, we have to put up with a little persecution from the enemy.
Sure.
So what? I win.
Because
he won for me. Silver, gold, and goods with beasts. Of course, that was the ride. That was the vehicle to get there, amen? Plus animals for sacrifice. Besides the freewill offering for the house of God that is in Jerusalem. Cyrus is telling them, not only help with the stuff they need, but you need to check your own heart and find out what God wants you to give, not just to for the provision for them to get there, but for the house.
Yes, amen.
God gave people in Babylon an opportunity, and in other nations as well, to be a part, partaking in building the glorious temple.
Amen. Yep.
Thank you, Jesus.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Lord.
Amen.
Verse 5, then rose up the chief of the fathers of Judah and Benjamin and the priests and the Levites with all them whose spirit God had raised to go up to build the house of the Lord, which is at Jerusalem. See, there again, there's a whole bunch of Jews that they just think just went right over their head. They were carnal. They weren't listening to the prophets. They'd been sitting in a nation that they knew wasn't their nation, that God hadn't given them for 70 years, and that had been being taught and preached and revealed that they were only going to be there 70 years. It's like the Lord told me one day. He said, you can be old or you can be an elder. It's up to you. You can just sit there and get old and die, or you can participate in what I'm...
Yes.
You can be an older or you can be an elder. That's what he told me. I choose to be an elder. And all they that were about them strengthened their hands with vessels of silver and gold and goods and with beasts and precious things, besides all that was willingly offered. God started stirring up people. They wanted to get in on this. They didn't even know maybe what it was or why it was, but they started getting, they wanted to participate. Verse 7, also Cyrus, the king, brought forth the vessels of the house of the Lord, which Nebuchadnezzar had brought forth out of Jerusalem, and had put them in the house of his gods. Now notice, if you know the story about that, when Nebuchadnezzar took them into bondage, and he took Daniel and the three children, Hebrew children with him and all that, that all happened during that time, he brought all of the silver and gold vessels that they used to worship God in the temple. He brought them in and he put them. And you read his history in the book of Daniel, he's kind of an up and down, back and forth guy. But finally, his son didn't do such a bang up job, but his grandson got power, and one night they had a drunken party. And they went and got the holy vessels of God out and filled them full of wine and had a drunken party. And all of a sudden, they probably thought they were really drunk when they saw this. They looked at the wall and there was a hand writing something on the wall. And they couldn't read it. So they brought Daniel in because they knew he knew God. And the writing said, you have been weighed in the balance and found wanting. In other words, you're done. And this night, and matter of fact, while that was all happening, the enemies were at the gate, bashing the gate into the city, coming in to take over. They lost their kingdom that night.
Yes.
Cyrus said, I'm going to see to it that the church is going to have everything they need to be what they need to be.
Amen.
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 Lord. Thank you, Lord God.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
See, there's the things we can believe for under the Cyrus season. We can believe for favor to come from every direction.
Yes.
And there are going to be people that have realized they've misused the things of God. They've, been out in a situation where they are really in danger. And they're going to say, wait a minute, these things are holy. And they're going to begin to, return to the Lord and help us use the things of God in a right way. Praise God. Amen?
Yeah.
Verse 8. Even those did Cyrus, the king of Persia, bring forth by the hand of whatever his name is, the treasurer, and numbered them unto Sheshbazzar, the prince of Judah. That's it, Sheshbazzar.
That's a bad name, man.
Yeah, I wouldn't want that name either.
Me neither.
I don't think. Have to look it up and see what it means.
Yeah.
Verse 9. And this is the number of them, 30 charges of gold, 1,000 charges of silver, 9 and 20 knives, 30 basins of gold, silver basins of a second sort, 410, and other vessels of 1,000. All the vessels of gold and silver were 5,400. All these did Sheshbazzar bring up with them of the captivity and were brought up from Babylon unto Jerusalem. Now, I didn't say I was going to quit here, didn't I? But I can't because there's one more scripture. It would be incomplete without this. I didn't look down far enough on my notes. Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4. Here's another Cyrus season. Now, the main characteristic I want you to, two things I guess I want you to get out of this tonight is, number one, understand the spiritual season here. It's hard to partake of it, be blessed by it, enter into it if you don't understand what it is and what's going on right now, what God has for you. Secondly, is the characteristic of this season is the main thing is a kingly decree. Now, when the king decrees something, you and I are to decree what he decrees in the earth. When he decrees it in heaven, and the Holy Spirit shows it to us, we are to decree it into the earth.
Amen.
Anybody ever hear of a town crier?
Yeah.
In the old days? Hear ye, the guy's ringing the bell, ding, 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 you know. And all the townspeople gather up. Why? Because this man has an official governmental position to get a decree that is written from the king, and then to, in his mouth, say the decree that the king said. To decree that, to release that into the atmosphere of that village or that town or that area, and it become, when the people hear it now, they are required by it, it is law, they have to submit to that.
Right.
Every demon knows that we are in a time of Cyrus right now. Every demon knows that their days of doing in the United States what they've done is over.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
When the children of Israel got to Jordan, that first group, that first bunch of people. And, you know, God had told Abraham 400 years before, when he was in the land, he said, now people are going to go into a land, and he says, they're going to be, eventually, they're going to be mistreated there, but I'm going to bring them out with a mighty hand, I'm going to bring them to this land, and 400 years later, they're going to come in, and they're going to have this land as their inheritance. He says, but I can't do it now, because the cup of the Amorites is not yet full. The Amorites were the evil people that were living in the land at that time, worshiping Baal, sacrificing their children, killing their children, you know, all these wild sex, orgy, crazy stuff where they were worshiping these devils. But yet God, in his mercy, was giving them time to repent. The scriptures even say over in Revelation that he gave Jezebel time to repent. This is one of the things people get fooled by. They think, my goodness, nothing happened. Yeah, something happened. You had a little more something be poured into your cup.
Yeah.
But when that cup is full and the evil overflows, God says, that's it. 400 years later, the cup of the Amorites were full. The Jews are brought right up, the Hebrews are brought right up to Jordan, to the boundary of the land. God says, go in. They saw the giants. They saw the walled cities. They saw the natural stuff that looked like they couldn't overcome. And they, you know, they cried out in fear and refused to go in. And I believe it was Caleb, if I remember correctly, he said, listen, those people are lunch for us. They're bread for us.
Amen.
Because their covering is gone.
Yeah.
Yes.
Their season is over.
Yes.
The devil can't protect them any longer. We can go in because now the season has shifted.
That's it. Yes.
But what did they do? They spent 40 more years on a camping trip in the desert because they refused to go in even when they could have went in. You have to recognize the season.
Yeah.
You have to act on the season. You have to know what season you're in. You have to understand what God has decreed. You need to decree. Pick up the sword of the Spirit. Go forward. Be like David. Don't let the giant tell you what he's going to do to you. You tell him what you're going to do to him.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't have a covenant with God. There's no protection on him. His time is up. And it's time for the people of God to inherit all that belongs to them.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
It's true.
Back in about 2010, the Lord spoke to me one day and he said, the church of the future will look a whole lot more like an army than a flock of sheep.
Yeah.
Come on.
There's time to be a sheep and there's time to be a soldier.
Right.
Amen. Did you find Luke 4? Here's Jesus. got baptized in water, filled with the Holy Ghost, went into the wilderness to fast and pray for 40 days. He was actually redeeming Israel for their 40 years of rebellion. The enemy comes, you know the story, the devil comes to tempt him. Verse 3 says, the devil said to him, if you're the Son of God, command this stone to be made bread. He told him this right when he was at the point of starvation. Jesus answered him and said, what? It is written. What did he do? He spoke the decree of God.
Amen.
He spoke the decree of God.
Yeah.
A decree is an edict spoken and then written into governing law. Jesus was saying, I agree with the decree. And God has told me that he's the source of my life, that he's my bread, he's my sustenance.
Yes.
His word is my sustenance, it's my manna.
Amen.
And he hasn't told me to eat yet. He told me not to eat, and he hasn't told me to eat yet. And so I decree what he decreed.
Yeah.
And you notice the devil didn't argue.
Right.
Because he had to bow his knee to the decree. And of course, the same thing in the three different areas there where he did that. But now look at verse 16. And Jesus came to Nazareth where he'd been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it is written. Where it is written. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me.
Yes.
To preach or proclaim. Mm-hmm. Really, the word there is actually, it's the word that we get evangelist from.
Yeah.
It's kind of more of an announcement. Okay. Not the announcements like we do out of our bulletin every week, but to announce the season.
Yeah.
He was announcing the season. This is the season we're in. And here's what happens in that season, he said, to announce the season, or to preach the good news to the poor. What's good news to the poor? You don't have to be poor no more.
Amen.
He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted. And to, now this word preach is more of a word that means to decree or proclaim, or to be a herald, or to be one who is like that town crier. He's decreeing something. To decree deliverance to the captives. Isn't that what the Cyrus decree did?
Yes.
He decreed, these people don't have to stay in Babylon anymore. I decree they're going back to their land and they get to have everything they need to get back there. And once they get there, they get to finish their destiny in the land and walk back into the fullness of their inheritance.
Amen.
That's the season we're in.
Yes.
Amen. That's the season that we're in.
Yes.
You and I need to begin to agree with the decree. We need to step in. See, I wasn't planning on going to this area, but you and I are kings and priests.
Amen.
That's what it says in Revelation.
Amen.
Jesus is a king and a priest after the order of Melchizedek.
Yeah.
Jesus is the great high priest, it says, of our profession. The Bible also says in Hebrews 1 that when he came to heaven, he was seated. And he was given a throne. He was seated in a throne. He was given a scepter of righteousness. He's a king. The Bible says in Ephesians 2:8, we've been raised up together and seated together with him in heavenly places. We have a twofold ministry of priest and king. A priest is one who ministers to the Lord, one who spends time blessing and praising the Lord and before the Lord. And in that priestly ministry, we hear his voice. He makes his decrees. And then we step into that place of being a king on this earth. He's the king of kings.
Yes, amen.
And what he says, we begin to say. We begin to decree. We don't just, I hope this will happen. We begin to say, it is written. It has been spoken. Study your Bible. There's a lot of books that are going to be opened in heaven.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. There's a book about you there.
Yes.
There is.
Amen.
There's a book about you there that's going to be read before God. Hallelujah.
Lord.
Oh, no, Pastor. Oh, no. No, no, no. That stuff's not in there anymore.
Right.
Oh, Lord.
Yep.
It was purged by the blood.
Amen.
Some people think when we get before the judgment seat of Christ, Jesus is going to point out all of our bad stuff and our good stuff. No, he's not. If he is, he's a liar. Because he says, my sins are purged. Not hidden and brought out later. Ah! Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
See, God sees you through his son.
Yes.
Amen. Glory to God.
Glory to God. But the Lord has been emphasizing the last couple of weeks, even during Todd's meetings, emphasizing deliverance. God's people were in bondage in Babylon. They had to be delivered out. They had to have God, the deliverer, come and deliver them out. He used the king's decree. He released a decree. And when they acted on that decree and began to act like they were free, freedom came.
Yes.
Amen.
Now, the Lord showed us during those meetings that there was, he showed me that the first time. I hadn't even talked to Todd. He was in town. I hadn't spoken to him at all. We were having worship that night. I came up here at the end of worship. The Lord had showed me, I saw people getting delivered from drug addiction.
Yeah.
And the Lord told me they're going to meet Jesus, the deliverer.
Yes.
Is that what it says here? Jesus is decreeing to preach deliverance to the captives.
Right.
Amen.
Amen?
Yep.
And then Todd got all excited because he had that dream the night before. And he saw the sword of the Lord. And he took it in his hand and began to swing it. And he saw chains being cut off of people and people being delivered. And the Lord gave him further information about how that people were going to be set free from drugs. And it was going to cause the family to be able to come together and be renewed.
Yes.
And restored.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Amen.
Praise God. Let's finish this. Preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind. You see, when you break that demonic darkness and bondage off of people, all of a sudden they start seeing, like Karen was talking about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
They start understanding and seeing what God has to set at liberty them that are bruised, or that word bruised means crushed. People that have just been crushed by the enemy and his persecution and his stuff in their life. Hallelujah. Verse 19, to proclaim, to decree, the acceptable year of the Lord. That is a reference to the year of Jubilee, and the characteristic of the year of Jubilee is freedom.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Free to go back.
Amen.
Back to the future.
Amen.
You have a future because you go back.
Yes.
To that place. You go back to Beersheba.
Yep.
As Mike was talking this morning.
Yep.
Every seed of Abraham and his general lineage there, they would, at one point in their life, they would go to Beersheba and hear from God, and he would launch them into their future.
Yeah.
Beersheba wasn't just a place of a well. It means the seventh well. And the seven, here we are in 5777. Seven means to fully commit yourself. God fully committed himself in an agreement he made with Abraham there. And Abraham called him, Olam El, you are not only the God of my past, you have done everything you said you'd do. You gave me a son and you gave me land. You fulfilled your promise. But you are Olam El. You're the God of my future. And God says, is that right? Well, give me your future. Take your son down here and give him to me. And when Abraham did that, it established Olam El. And he planted an evergreen tree, which was symbolic of the everlasting covenant. And so his relatives would come back to that place and seek God. What do I do? God says, go ahead, Jacob. Go on into Egypt. You're going to die there, but you're going to fulfill the end of your life, the purpose that I put you in. You're going to increase there. You're going to become millions of people there. And they're going to come back and have a land. So God is telling us right now, I want to take you back to the future. I want to take you back and establish something. You agree with me. You decree with me. You go back under what I'm sending you to, and I will launch you into your future, and you will fulfill everything the people behind you didn't fulfill.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Praise God.
I don't care what sins my forefathers created. My bloodline has been cut off through the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
God is my Father. His DNA runs through me.
Yes.
His life and his nature.
Yes.
And I'm going to have everything in my life that God wants me to have so that I can be a blessing in this season.
Amen.
Did you guys get this?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Let's stand up. Praise God. Sometimes I wonder, I get to jump around on so many different things. I wonder if I'm just kind of, it makes sense to me, but I'm kind of putting it out there in a way. Hallelujah.
Good.
Just brand this in your heart and your mind. I'm going to agree with the decree. I'm going to operate as a king on this earth. We've already heard from the Lord. And he has made and is making decrees over my family, over my life, over my city, over my state, my nation. And I am going to agree with that and decree it. And every time the devil shows up or shows out or tries to convince me of something, I am going to do what Jesus said. It is written, because it has been said. It's law. It's decree. It has the king's stamp of authority on it. And so here, devil, is what's going to happen. Not what you say is going to happen. I agree with the decree. Well, I don't know what he's decreed about my family. Get with him and he'll tell you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Seek him. Worship him. Say, God, talk to me about my family. What do you say about my family? What do you say about this? He'll give you scripture. He'll show you something. He'll speak something. He may give you a dream or vision. And then you take that and you begin to use it as a sword in the spirit. You begin to decree. Amen. Father, we thank you for the season we live in. The Cyrus season. This season where you are returning your people back to the fullness of their inheritance. We don't have to live under a Babylonian system that would just keep us from all that you called us to. But Father, we choose to stand up and go back. We're not just going to stay here in comfy zone. We're not just going to stay here and agree and try to think that somehow things are going to work out for us if we just don't stir the enemy up somehow. But God, I thank you for bold people. I thank you for prophetic people. I thank you for people that will pray and prophesy. People that will decree. People that will act on what you said to them. People that will tell the devil, here's what's going to happen. Here's what God has decreed. From that position of victory, Father, we thank you for it tonight. We praise you for it tonight. Just lift your hands and thank him for it. Hallelujah, I thank you, Father. I bless you and I praise you. I give you glory. I magnify you, Lord. It's time for you to pull out all those prophetic words you've gotten from God and decree them. Now's the season. Now's the time. Turn them from just a promise, just something you hope happens, into a decree. It is written. When God said that, he decreed it. It's written in heaven.
Thank you, God.
Yes. Hallelujah. It's law. The devil knows it.
Yes.
That's why he's trying to make it look like anything but that's going to happen. You just tell him, thus saith the Lord. This is the decree. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father. Glory to God. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Well, praise God. Hallelujah. Anybody else got anything? Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Lord. Oh, the Lord is good.
Yes. Praise God. I'll tell you why, you're going to be, before it's over, you're going to be so glad you were born in this church.
Amen. Amen.
I'm not saying there's not going to be a lot of crazy stuff happening. There will be. Because God is rooting the devil out.
Amen.
He's ripping him out. He's casting him out.
Yep.
He's running him off.
Yes.
You and I, there's going to be a lot of deliverance just by what we say.
Yeah. Ripping the devil out of our government in California.
Amen.
Amen. Ripping him out of wherever he's at.
Amen.
It's time for this nation to have its,
Lord.
Its prophetic fulfillment.
Thank you, Father.
You want to find out what it is? Read Brother Henry's book, God, Gold, and Glory.
Amen.
Yep.
Powerful book. Father, thank you. Thank you for what you're doing. You're using people in this room. You have used them. They prove themselves faithful, and you are promoting them. You are lifting them up. You're increasing their anointing, their capacity to minister. You're bringing people to them to aid and assist them to fulfill what you've called them to do. You're bringing finance. You're bringing all the things that need to be done. People with giftings and abilities. People to serve and people to help. People that don't even know you. Your word promises us in Jeremiah 33 that you'll cause people to come to us that don't know you, but they'll serve us willingly. I thank you for it.
Thank you, God.
We thank you for it.
So praise the Lord.
Thank you.
We thank you for it.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Well, praise
thank
the Lord.
Lord.
I don't have anything else.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's just go home and agree with the decree.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you.